So I'm here getting ready to make a video here. This little waterfall falls from my lake down this stream all the way to Lake Michigan. This little lake is higher than Lake Michigan, and so the gravity just naturally takes the water down this waterfall and out to Lake Michigan. There's a couple little waterfalls along the way. Here's one connecting my lake to Lake Michigan. You can see the little bridge over the top. You can see Dayton and Alice are gonna try to burn some energy here. But today we're gonna talk about the Enlightenment back in the colonial era. Guys, the Enlightenment is also known as the Age of Reason or the Age of Science. They apply reason and science to science, government, religion, to all sorts of things. Ben Franklin is considered the embodiment of the Enlightenment in America, representing the Enlightenment more than any other person in America.
So I have good aim.
All right, not too bad, buddy.
It doesn't shoot far enough, whatever. It would have hit those trees, and I was aiming for those trees, and it would have hit it if it went farther.
All right, let me get this done so we can explore, okay, buddy? All right. Now, guys, so this Age of Reason, Age of Science, Ben Franklin's the embodiment of the Enlightenment in America. So Ben Franklin, I mean, look at, he's a diplomat, a scientist, a politician, an inventor, an author, a publisher. He does a little bit of everything. And he pushes a lot of these Enlightenment ideas in so many ways. I mean, remember, Ben Franklin's at the Constitutional Convention. He's in the Continental Congress. He's in the Albany Congress during the, basically around the time of the Seven Years' War, also known as the French and Indian War. He does a little bit of everything. But the Enlightenment, it promotes religious tolerance during this era. This concept that it's okay to have different religions or different types of Christianity, different denominations of Christianity in America. Here's a famous quote by James Madison. Conscience is the most sacred of all property. So he uses this to say, look, we have religious tolerance, we have religious freedom. I have the right to have my own conscience on religion. And it's a sacred property that people can't tell me what to think on religion or force me to think or force me to behave a certain way in religion. Cool, buddy. Ben Franklin donated to every building of a place of worship in Philadelphia that was created in his adult lifetime, even a Jewish synagogue. And so the first Jewish synagogue in Philadelphia. So Franklin, these actions exemplify this religious tolerance. He donates to Quakers. He donates to Presbyterians. He donates to every type of religious building in Philadelphia getting created during his lifetime. He attends a variety of churches. He's a Presbyterian, but he'll also attend Anglican services. This idea of religious tolerance. George Washington would attend all sorts of religious ceremonies. And part of it's to unify the country, but it's also because he believes in this idea of religious tolerance. In fact, during the American Revolution, he comes upon some soldiers getting ready to burn this Catholic effigy, and he orders them not to do it, and he orders his soldiers not to persecute Catholics. George Washington goes through great pains to make sure that we're a religiously tolerant country, that we don't persecute other people. A lot of our founding fathers saw what was happening in Europe. Remember, a lot of our colonists who ended up moving to America came here to escape religious persecution. And some of our founding fathers wanted to make this a land where people wouldn't be persecuted for their religion or their lack of religion. Thomas Jefferson, who I could have put on here, who passed religious laws in Virginia and stuff like that and freedom. Thomas Jefferson said, you know, I'm going to butcher the quote a little bit here, but to paraphrase, he said something to the effect of, "It neither picks my pocket nor breaks my leg if a man worships 20 gods or no god at all." A lot of the founding fathers really pushed this Enlightenment theme of religious tolerance, part of the Enlightenment. One of the biggest things in the Enlightenment is religious tolerance. Republicanism. And remember, I'm using republicanism not in the, like, what you might think of in the modern political partisan sense of like Republican Party versus Democratic Party. But republicanism, at its root means without a monarchy. You don't have a king. You don't have Queen Elizabeth II without a monarchy. And republicanism is more than just monarchy. It means economic freedom. It opposes mercantilism, this economic system that the British monarchy and parliament thrust upon the American colonies, this mercantilism, where the British government's trying to create a surplus of gold, and they put severe restrictions on the American colonies of who we can trade with, who we can't trade with, who can do what, who can't do what. And they'll give monopolies to people. And republicanism in America in the Enlightenment also pushes forward this economic freedom. I have freedom to create businesses as I please without the government saying, no, only this area can do businesses of that type, which is what mercantilism was doing. Republicanism also tries to look at, in the American Enlightenment anyways, tries to put forward this idea of government as a science. That you look at government with reason and science, political science is a degree that some of you kids might be interested in. And part of this republicanism during this Enlightenment is this idea that America has less social barriers. We don't have a monarchy. We don't have an aristocracy. We don't have nobility. There's nobody I have to bow to. And because of this, hard work equals success. Hard work equals success. And if you work hard, you're going to find success. That's all tied into this republicanism during the Enlightenment. John Locke, although he's not American, never stepped foot in America, he's British. But the fact of the matter is, guys, John Locke has a huge impact on America under this Enlightenment. He pushes forward lots of Enlightenment ideas, far more than I have on here. But he builds upon the social contract theory, this idea that the government gets its rights from the consent of the governed. And that by staying here, I kind of agree to live under this government concept, or I can break it down if they no longer have the consent. So basically, guys, he also builds upon inalienable rights, that there's certain rights I'm just born with, given to me by my creator. Notice, you're going to see that concept, both these first two concepts, actually, in the American Declaration of Independence. The Founding Fathers read John Locke. That's why he's so important to the American Enlightenment. The Founding Fathers read John Locke and liked a lot of his ideas, discussed his ideas, debated his ideas. He talks about separation of powers in government. He talks about economic ideas. But notice, separation of powers is a key part of the American U.S. Constitution. If any one document represents the Enlightenment in American history, it's probably the Declaration of Independence, the inalienable rights that the people can overthrow their government if the government is no longer ruling with the consent of the governed. And so this helps, the Enlightenment helps build ideas that the American Revolution is founded upon. A lot of historians talk about how the Enlightenment is just so critical to the to the American Revolution. It's just so important. That pipe, that irrigation pipe, is kind of blocking a view of that waterfall a little bit there. But, oh, there goes a car. But guys, the Enlightenment interacts with the First Great Awakening. Benjamin Franklin, who I said embodied the Enlightenment in America, he's actually friends with and debates and does things with George Whitefield, who's arguably the most influential person of the First Great Awakening. The Enlightenment starts first. It's this age of reason, age of science. The First Great Awakening starts after the Enlightenment's already going, but then they're going on concurrently at the same time. Enlightenment starts first. The First Great Awakening is kind of like a counter movement, a reaction to it. And then they're going on concurrently at the exact same time. But the First Great Awakening is this religious revival. And it doesn't like how this age of science is sometimes criticizing some things that were described as acts of God before, such as lightning, which gets determined to be basically a form of electricity with some of, actually Ben Franklin's actually helping with a lot of that. But the fact of the matter is, guys, this Enlightenment's huge. It's important to American history. It's important to colonial America. It's important to the American Revolution. It's important to our founding documents, our founding ideas. Guys, a lot of the Enlightenment ideas, you see it in who we say we are. The Declaration of Independence, all men are created equal. We all have inalienable rights given to us by our Creator. They can't justly be taken away. And guys, There's different dates about when this exactly starts and when it exactly ends. But the fact of the matter is, most people say it starts in the late 1600s and ends in the early 1800s, but the 1700s, the late 1700s especially, that's the heart of this Enlightenment, at least for America. The Enlightenment's also going on in Europe, but we're talking about U.S. history here. So guys, please send me feedback. Do you like these? Are these helping? Are you guys actually watching and getting stuff? Give me some feedback. You can send me an email if you want. But hey, Dayton, do you have anything you want to say to the people? I'm almost done.
I do.
You seriously only found one golf ball so far.
Okay, we'll find more. And Alice?
I made a little space where you can store our stuff.
Oh, cool. We're going to go explore. Find golf balls, yeah, maybe find some animals in the woods.
And I can't wait till we go over there.
Last time Dayton and I were in the woods, we saw a turkey, some woodpeckers, and some other stuff. Whoa. I'm getting tackled. Oh, that's a big turkey. Okay. All right. Well, guys, stay safe. I'll try to stay safe from this wild turkey. Oh, all right. Have a good day, guys.